Hey there, I'm Mike, and today I'm going to guide you through handling errors in JavaScript. If you're building a JavaScript application, there's a high chance you'll mess with the data types at one point or another. If not that, then you might end up replacing an undefined with a null or a triple equals operator with a double equals operator. It's only human to make mistakes. That is why in this video, I will show you everything you need to know about handling errors in JavaScript. But before we get too far, I want to let you know that there'll be links to more resources in the video's description below. And always remember, subscribe and ring that bell to get notifications for future helpful content. Now, let's look at how to identify and prevent errors in JavaScript. The most fundamental way of handling errors that have been thrown either manually or by the runtime is to catch them. Like most other languages, JavaScript offers a set of keywords to handle errors. It's essential to know each of them in depth before you sit down to handle errors in your JavaScript app. The first and most basic keyword of the set is throw. As evident, the throw keyword is used to throw errors to create exceptions in the JavaScript runtime manually. Here's the gist of the keyword significance. You can throw anything, including numbers, strings, and error objects. However, it's not advisable to throw primitive data types such as strings and numbers since they don't carry debug information about the errors. The try keyword is used to indicate that a block of code might throw an exception. Its syntax is this. It's important to note that a catch block must always follow the try block to handle errors effectively. The catch keyword is used to create a catch block. This block of code is responsible for handling the errors that the trailing try block catches. Here is its syntax. Unlike C++ or Java, you can't append multiple catch blocks to a try block in JavaScript. This means that you can't do this. Instead, you can use an if-else statement or a switch case statement inside the single catch block to handle all possible error cases. It would look like this. The finally keyword is used to define a code block that is run after an error has been handled. This block is executed after the try and the catch blocks. Also, the finally block will be executed regardless of the result of the other two blocks. This means that even if the catch block cannot handle the error entirely, or an error is thrown in the catch block, the interpreter will execute the code in the finally block before the program crashes. To be considered valid, the try block in JavaScript needs to be followed by either a catch or a finally block. Without any of those, the interpreter will raise a syntax error. Therefore, make sure to follow your try blocks with at least either of them when handling errors. The onerror method is available to all HTML elements for handling any errors that may occur with them. For instance, if an image tag cannot find the image whose URL is specified, it fires its onerror method to allow the user to handle the error. Typically, you would provide another image URL in the onerror call for the image tag to fall back to. This is how you can do that via JavaScript. However, you can use this feature to create a global error handling mechanism for your app. Here's how you can do it. With this event handler, you can get rid of the multiple try catch blocks lying around in your code and centralize your app's error handling similar to event handling. You can attach multiple error handlers to the window to maintain the single responsibility principle from the solid design principles. The interpreter will cycle through all handlers until it reaches the appropriate one. While simple and linear functions allow error handling to remain simple, callbacks can complicate the affair. Consider the following piece of code. The above function demonstrates an asynchronous condition in which a function takes some time to process operations and returns the result later with the help of a callback. If you try to enter a string instead of a 4 in the function call, you'll get NaN as a result. This needs to be handled properly. Here's how. This should solve the problem ideally. However, if you try passing a string to the function call, you'll receive this. Even though you have implemented a try-catch block while calling the function, it still says the error is uncaught. The error is thrown after the catch block has been executed due to the timeout delay. This can occur quickly in network calls where unexpected delays creep in. You need to cover such cases while developing your app. Here's how you can handle errors properly in callbacks. Now, the output at the console will be this. This indicates that the error has been appropriately handled. Most people tend to prefer promises for handling asynchronous activities. Promises have another advantage. A rejected promise doesn't terminate your script. However, you still need to implement a catch block to handle errors and promises. To understand this better, let's rewrite the calculateCube function using promises. The timeout from the previous code has been isolated into a delay function for understanding. If you try to enter a string instead of a 4, the output that you get will be similar to this. Again, this is due to the promise throwing the error after everything has completed execution. The solution to this issue is simple. Simply add a catch call to the promise chain like this. Now, the output would be like this. You can observe how easy it is to handle errors with promises. Additionally, you can chain a finally block and the promise call to add code that will run after error handling has been completed. Alternatively, you can also handle errors and promises using the traditional try-catch-finally technique. Here's how your promise call will look in that case. However, this works inside an asynchronous function only. Therefore, the most preferred way to handle errors and promises is to chain catch and finally to the promise call. With 4 methods at your disposal, you must know how to choose the most appropriate in any given use case. You will be using this method most of the time. Make sure to implement conditions for all possible errors inside your catch block, and remember to include a finally block if you need to run some memory cleanup routines after the try block. However, too many try-catch blocks can make your code difficult to maintain. If you find yourself in such a situation, you might want to handle errors via the globe handler or the promise method. When deciding between asynchronous try-catch blocks and promises catch, it's advisable to go with the async try-catch blocks since they will make your code linear and easy to debug. It's best to use the onerror method when you know that your app has to handle many errors and they can be well scattered throughout the code base. The onerror method enables you to handle errors as if they were just another event handled by your application. You can define multiple error handlers and attach them to your app's window on the initial rendering. However, you must also remember that the onerror method can be unnecessarily challenging to set up in smaller projects with a lesser scope of error. If you're sure that your app will not throw too many errors, the traditional throw-catch method will work best for you. Error handling in callbacks and promises differs due to the code design and structure. However, if you choose between these two before you have written your code, it would be best to go with promises. This is because promises have an inbuilt construct for chaining a catch and finally block to handle errors easily. This method is easier and cleaner than defining additional arguments, reusing existing arguments to handle errors. Many errors often arise due to manual mistakes in the code base. While developing or debugging your code, you might end up making unnecessary changes that may cause new errors to appear in your code base. Automated testing is a great way to keep your code in check after every change. However, it can only tell you if something's wrong. If you don't take frequent backups of your code, you'll end up wasting time trying to fix a function or a script that was working just fine before. This is where Git plays its role. With a proper commit strategy, you can use your Git history as a backup system to view your code as it's evolved through the development. You can easily browse through your older commits and find out the version of the function working fine before, but throwing errors after an unrelated change. You can then restore the old code or compare the two versions to determine what went wrong. Modern web development tools like GitHub Desktop help you to visualize these changes side by side and figure out the mistakes quickly. A habit that can help you make fewer errors is running code reviews whenever you make a significant change to your code. If you're working in a team, you can create a pull request and have a team member review it thoroughly. This will help you use a second pair of eyes to spot out any errors that might have slipped by you. It's advisable to use custom errors wherever possible instead of the generic error class, as it provides more contextual information to the calling environment about the error. On top of that, custom errors allow you to moderate how an error is displayed to the calling environment. This means that you can choose to hide specific details or display additional information about the error as and when you wish. You can go as far as to format the error contents according to your needs. This gives you better control over how the error is interpreted and handled. Even the most senior developers often make a rookie mistake, consuming exceptions levels deep down in their code. You might come across situations where you have a piece of code that is optional to run. If it works, great. If it doesn't, you don't need to do anything about it. In these cases, it's often tempting to put this code in a try block and attach an empty catch block to it. However, by doing this, you'll leave the piece of code open to causing any kind of error and getting away with it. This can become dangerous if you have a large code base and many instances of such poor error management constructs. The best way to handle exceptions is to determine a level on which all of them will be dealt and raise them until there. This level can be a controller in an MVC architecture app or a middleware in a traditional server-oriented app. This way, you'll get to know where you can find all the errors occurring in your app and choose how to resolve them, even if it means not doing anything about them. Logging an error is often an integral part of handling it. Those who fail to develop a centralized strategy for logging errors may miss out on valuable information about their app's usage. An app's event logs can help you figure out crucial data about errors and help to debug them quickly. If you have proper alerting mechanisms set on your app, you can know when an error occurs in your app before it reaches a large section of your user base. It's advisable to use a pre-built logger or create one to suit your needs. You can configure this logger to handle errors based on their levels, and some loggers even go as far as to send logs to remote logging servers immediately. This way, you can watch how your application's logic performs with active users. All errors that interfere with the normal functioning of your app must present a visible alert to the user to notify them that something went wrong so the user can try to work out a solution. If you know a quick fix for the error, such as retrying an operation or logging out and logging back in, make sure to mention it in the alert to help fix the user experience in real time. In the case of errors that don't cause any interference with the everyday user experience, you can consider suppressing the alert and logging the error into a remote server for resolving later. The Node.js environment supports middlewares to add functionalities to server applications. You can use this feature to create an error handling middleware for your server. The most significant benefit to using middleware is that all of your errors are handled centrally in one place. You can choose to enable or disable this setup for testing purposes easily. Here's how you can create a basic middleware. You can then use this middleware in your app like this. You can now define custom logic inside the middleware to handle errors appropriately. You don't need to worry about implementing individual error handling constructs throughout your codebase anymore. When Node.js apps encounter programmer errors, they might not necessarily throw an exception and try to close the app. Such errors can include issues arising from programmer mistakes like high CPU consumption, memory bloating, or memory leaks. The best way to handle these is to gracefully restart the app by crashing it via the Node.js cluster mode or a unique tool like PM2. This can ensure that the app doesn't crash upon a user action, presenting a terrible user experience. You can never be sure that you have covered every possible error that can occur in your app. Therefore, it's essential to implement a fallback strategy to catch all uncaught exceptions from your app. Here's how you can do that. You can also identify if the error that occurred is a standard exception or a custom operational error. Based on the result, you can exit the process and restart it to avoid unexpected behavior. Similar to how you can never cover for all possible exceptions, there's a high chance that you might miss out on handling all possible promise rejections. However, unlike exceptions, promise rejections don't throw errors. So, an important promise that was rejected might slip by as a warning and leave your app open to the possibility of running into unexpected behavior. Therefore, it's crucial to implement a fallback mechanism for handling promise rejection. Here's how you can do that. Like any other programming language, errors are quite frequent and natural in JavaScript. In some cases, you might even need to throw errors intentionally to indicate the correct response to your users. Hence, understanding their anatomy and types is very crucial. Moreover, you need to be equipped with the right tools and techniques to identify and prevent errors from taking down your application. Do you have any techniques for handling JavaScript errors constructively? Let us know in the comments below. Looking for a quality local development solution? With Dev Kinsta, in a single click, you can design, develop, and deploy new WordPress projects from your local machine. Plus, it's 100% free to use, even if you aren't a Kinsta customer. Download it today at kinsta.com/devkinsta. Thank you so much for watching. If you found this video helpful, please don't forget to like, subscribe, and hit the notification bell for more tutorials, explainers, and helpful content like this.